seven churches. You know, it's interesting. I love the fact that we have done the Revelation series before. And this time it's completely different from the last time that we did it. But I also, the last time, I don't know, it was like a seriousness attached to it. But this one, it's a little lighthearted, if that's all right. I feel good about it. I'm enjoying it. It's practical. It's every day. And it's more simple, and therefore it's more powerful. If it means something to me today, then it's powerful. It means something to me tomorrow, then I don't need it. It has to mean something to me today. You know, so when you look at Revelation, it's not about our future. It has to be about our now, otherwise we don't care so much. So look at your notes with me. We're in the fourth chapter of Revelation tonight. We've gone through the seven churches. And let's read our text first. We're going to do the whole chapter tonight, 11 verses. And then we'll talk after we read our text. Well, Pastor Dad, if you'll start the reading for us, please.
After these things, I looked, and behold, the door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard sounded like a trumpet speaking to me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. Immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, the throne in heaven sat on the one throne.
And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow about the throne that appears like a throne.
Around the throne were 24 thrones. And on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads.
And from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God.
Before the throne there was a sea of glass, like crystal, and in the midst of the throne, and around the throne, four living creatures full of eyes in front and in back.
The first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle.
The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
Give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever.
The 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying,
you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they will exist and create.
Excellent. The fourth chapter. That's good. You know, we've read this before. As you're reading it, I don't know. Sometimes when you read the passages, like, things start to spark, and, you know, you see things of interest. And I like doing things in group settings. Sometimes there's, more revealed in group settings sometimes, you know. Sometimes we're more involved. So, you know, with this passage, it's interesting. It's the title of tonight is The Throne of Heaven. And it seems as if John has been transported from earth to heaven. Prior to this, he gave us the commentary on the seven churches which were upon the earth, and then God wanted to transport John from earth to heaven. And, you know, when we think of earth and heaven, I must say there's still some kind of a natural understanding with us all where we kind of separate earth and heaven. Like, we live on earth, and heaven is up there somewhere, you know? I mean, you know, we still kind of like have those thoughts or you know, reflect that way. Has anybody ever, you know, think of earth as this realm right here, and heaven is up out there somewhere? So when you see this scene here and this vision and this throne room, it's like John literally went up into heaven and he saw something up in the heavens. But actually, that's not really accurate. You see, heaven and earth It's not a matter of as we say it all the time, it's not geographical location. Heaven and earth, it's a mindset. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of seeing, if you will. And let's choose that vocabulary tonight. It's a way of seeing. So you can look out into the world today. You can look into your neighborhood. You can look into your house, your family, your work, and you can see the earth realm. You could see, you know, everything we talked about in regard to the seven churches. You can see good things and bad things and people you like and people you don't like and good and evil, right? Sure. Or you know, you can have the experience that John had. You could be transported into heaven and you're not going to leave anywhere. You're not going to go from here to there. You could have the same experience that John had. And the only thing that would change is like a veil would be lifted from your eyes. Like something that shrouded you would be removed, and all of a sudden you'd see the heavens is in the same place you saw the earth. Like, you know, you look into your house or your school or your job, and you used to see like demons all around and the enemy all around, and like you remove the veil, and all of a sudden you see cherubs all around you. Like your house, my family is filled with angels, and the church is filled with angels, and my neighborhood is filled with angels. I thought they were devils the other day. All of a sudden, what's the difference, man? It's how we see things. It's our perception. And you've heard it said, it's been said many times, perception is your perception is your reality. What you see does make a difference in how you live. You know, you have the classic scenarios, the optimist and the pessimist. Is the glass half full or is the glass half empty? Do you see heaven or do you see hell? Do you see earth or heaven? It's just a matter of how you see things. And God decided to show John heaven without him going anywhere. The veil was removed, and all of a sudden he looked into the earth and he saw the throne room. He went nowhere, but his perception changed. That's all that happened from 3 to 4. And you know, we say the church was raptured and we were caught away from the earth to the heaven. All of that is true. It's just defined differently. You know, there is a rapture, but the rapture is a mental ascent or a spiritual ascent or a soul ascent. I don't care. Any one of the following. The only thing that changes is your understanding. You personally do not move an inch. You don't move an inch. And maybe those who have died and gone before us, maybe they didn't move an inch either. Maybe they just became invisible. Yeah. Because where is God? In heaven? Yeah, but he's also, he fills this room. Yeah, that's right. So that's really what we're looking at when we the transition between 3 and 4. As an illustration, if you have your Bibles, you can turn, but you don't have to. I'm going to turn to Matthew chapter 16. I can read it to you. And it's the encounter that Peter had with Jesus, where Jesus was saying, you know, who do men say that I am? All of a sudden, you know the account, right? And then Jesus said to Peter, well, Peter, who do you say that I am? Jesus says to Peter, who do you say that I am? You know, they replied, some say, you know, that he was John the Baptist. Some say that Jesus was Elijah. There were still others that said he was Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked to Peter. Who do you say that I am? What did Peter say?
You are Christ, Son of the living God.
Good. Powerful, right? Mm-hmm. Amazing. Amazing. Peter, the guy who was a brute. He used to be a brute beast, right? The guy that did all the cursing and swearing and beating everybody up and hurting people. This dude. He's the only guy that said, you're the Christ. I know who you are. You are Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, he said, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. Right? You know the rest? And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock, here we go, I will build my church. On this rock, I will build my church. Jesus was going to build his church. But also something else. My pen don't work. He said, And the gates of hell will not overcome it. He's going to build his church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. What else goes along with that? And I will give you the keys of the kingdom. Now take note. What do you do with the keys? Tell me what you do with the keys, everybody. What does the next verse say? Does anybody know by memory? Whatsoever. All right, I'll help you out, guys. I'll help you out. I know. It's been a long day. It says, I've given you the keys of the kingdom. Uh-huh. And whatever you bind on. Oh, there we go. We got some help from the back, man. Whatever you bind where? On earth will be bound. Take note of the two realms, earth and heaven. Take note of the two realms. Okay. And then it says, whatever you loose where? On earth will be loosed in heaven. Take note of the two realms. Okay. You have the earth. And you have the heaven. You see, Jesus said to Peter, he gave them both the church and heaven, because you can have access to both anytime. There's a distinct difference between the church and heaven, by the way, because heaven is in the heavens and church is on the earth. Church is on the earth. When the church is on the earth, you need to know that the gates of hell shall not prevail against you, because hell is on the earth too. See, hell's not in heaven. Hell's on the earth. So when you're on the earth, you're going to encounter hell. That's why he gave you the strong tower to run into and find shelter. He said, you can run into the church and you'll be safe against the forces of hell. Or you can go to heaven where there is no hell or devil and anything else, whichever one. So you can go to heaven. There's no devil there, no hell there. So you don't, you know, in heaven, you don't have to say the gates of hell should not prevail. The gates of hell aren't in heaven. They're on earth. That's where the church is. So God says, you know, while you're on earth, I'm going to give you a shelter, a place of a sanctuary, a temple, a refuge, all of the above, right? And you run to this place, and you'll find safety. Now, there's a physical truth to that. Upon this earth, how many of you have found sanctuary in this building? I have found sanctuary in this building. There have been times when I have been troubled, and I've come with many people, or I've come when the place was absolutely empty. This was my place of safety. It was my help. God gave us this gift, the church. When life in the world is full of everything, I come here. And thank God. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against this house, this place that God has given us. So it's a beautiful gift. But nowhere is that. It's on the earth. All right. But you see here in the book of Revelation, you know, you're talking about the churches. And then finally, God shows John a vision, and he takes him from the earth to the heavens where there is no church. You don't need a church because there's no devil. There's no hell. It's like heaven, you know, on the earth, you have synagogues and temples and tabernacles. In heaven, the whole place is a synagogue. You know, that's why when they describe heaven, it describes heaven as the sea of glass, right? And the cherubs that surround the throne. It's all a picture of the throne room. It's just that the heaven is all temple. There's nothing else but temple. There's no other entity but God. That's pretty good. And that's where John was transported. Once again, he didn't move an inch. The only thing that changed with John was his understanding, his vision. Whatever, revelation, realization, right? You ever have days like you think you're fighting the devil? I'm fighting that devil, I tell you, but I'm going to beat him. Right? No, yeah, sure. We all have, every single one of us. Huh? That devil's after me today. Yeah, I have days like that. Yeah, today was a day like that. Yeah, I could name the devils if you want. No, I won't do that because some of them are in the room. I'm only playing. Or you have days where it's like, devil, what devil? This is the easiest day of my life. It's nothing but blessing. I mean, I pray you've had days like that. I pray you've had days where it's like, devil, nothing. This is the easiest thing in the world. It's like you have been transported from earth to heaven. There's different realms. There's a realm where you're fighting the devil. There's a realm where there is no devil. What devil? What devil? Life is good. But I want us to see that the earth and the heaven are not different places. It's us that changes entirely. And that's what we see with John. And you remember the story, the famous story with Jacob. You ever hear the story of Jacob's ladder, where there were angels ascending and descending? That's you and I. We constantly transition from the earth to the heavens, constantly. So John was transported. You and I, during, listen, without you even knowing it, understanding it, knowing what the Bible is or what it says, you've had these experiences. You've had these experiences in life where you have been transported from the earth to the heaven. John was able to write about it because he had an understanding. You and I don't write about it because we don't know. We just go through life sometimes. Sometimes, you know, the hardest days in your life, and sometimes they're the easiest days in your life. I believe there's some kind of a transition going on, that God works in our lives all by himself. He don't need your permission. He don't even need you to know he's working in your life. That's pretty big and amazing, I think. So I want us to understand that. Let us read together the couple of sentences underneath our reading for tonight. It starts off. It says, Revelation 1:19 is God's inspired outline of this book. Revelation 4 ushers in the third division. And the third division is, if you remember, the things which shall be hereafter. Okay, and the things which shall be hereafter. Hereafter what? Hereafter what? The church age. There is something after the church age. There's something greater than the church age. You can tell me what that is. What is that? Very good, Elder Petrozello. It is the kingdom. The kingdom. Remember everybody? You all on board? Anybody here tonight? Thank you in the back. You see, the church age is not an enduring age. It's not enduring. And you can leave the church age without you moving an inch once again. So what will be hereafter? Well, what else is there besides the church? Well, there's something so much greater. See, Peter was given two things at the same time. He was given the church and the kingdom at the same time, because you can have both at the same time. You can transition in and out. Jesus Christ reveals to John the path that we will travel as we journey from the church age. The church age is in Revelation 1 to 3. And then from Revelation 1 to 3 to the end of the book is like a journey. It's the journey that you and I will take to go from the church age into the kingdom. How do you get into the kingdom? Well, Revelation 3 to the end of the book tells you how. And there's all kinds of stuff going on. That's the journey that you take. It's usually the road of tribulation, if you will, that takes you from the church age into the very kingdom of heaven. So John now takes us on the journey from the church age to the kingdom of God experienced in the end of the book of Revelation. You got that, everybody? That's what it is. It's a path that you and I are currently on, the kingdom. And once again, the kingdom isn't when you die. It's just when you get into it, man. It could be right now. Heaven will open. There will be a voice, okay, and the sound of a trumpet, and the saints will be caught up to heaven. The saints will be caught up to heaven. You guys ever hear about the saints being caught up? Anybody ever hear about the rapture? Well, that's what's going on between 3 and 4. Once again, nobody is really moving an inch. You could say that you are floating out of here, sure, but only in a spiritual way, not in a physical way. You can be raptured and your body stays right here. You can be raptured, caught up into the very presence of God. You can go from misery to euphoria in a matter of moments. Has anyone ever gone from misery to euphoria? Yeah, like when the check came in the mail, I went from misery to euphoria in the minute I was raptured. I was raptured in that very moment. So you've all been raptured. But you see, to be raptured is nothing physical. It's the change in your disposition. You go from earth to heaven, from sorrow to joy, from sickness to health, from weakness to strength, on and on. Amen.
Amen.
Excellent. Very good. Okay, Matt, now maybe we can turn the page. Let us turn the page. First one. Let us see. All right. Mm-hmm. Somebody read verse 1 for us again, please.
After this, grief, after these things marking the opening of the next vision.
I'm sorry, Randy, just read verse 1 in Revelation 1, Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, read the first verse again.
After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this.
Excellent. Very good. Very good. On page 40, it's verse 1, but it's the commentary of verse 1, friend. I don't know the verse itself. That's the commentary. Okay, so it says, after these things I looked and behold, like all of a sudden, God opens up your eye. Oh, that's great. Thanks. God opens up your eyes and my eyes. And all of a sudden, you and I see that heaven is open to us, man. Heaven is, and you know, as you walk through this porthole, you can walk into the very throne room of God, heaven itself, at any particular point in time. You know, it's usually by the Holy Spirit calling us, though. Well, it's always the work of God and the Spirit. And he says, I heard, this is the important part. He said, I heard the voice, and what did the voice sound like, everybody? It sounded like a trumpet. The reason why the voice sounded like a trumpet is because the trumpet is like a command. You know, you see the trumpet used many times, obviously in military, and but in many other times, the trumpet like gives a certain sound, and you know how to respond according to the sound of the trumpet. As a matter of fact, it's like the trumpet, you know, without you even mentally reacting to the trumpet, you could hear a certain, you in the military or whoever else in the military, you could hear the trumpet sound, and all of a sudden you just snap to attention like automatically, right? Like you didn't do it like make a decision, like you just automatically snap to attention. That's what the voice of God does. He's not waiting for you to respond. You will automatically, the Spirit of God inside of you will respond to the trumpet, and like your body's just going along for the ride, man. You have no choice. God speaks, you move, and you're wondering, where am I going? That's what it is. And it doesn't happen all the time, but there are times when there's a trumpet sound. There's the voice of God. It's a certain command. You ever read in Thessalonians where it says, like, at the last trump? At the last trump, what would happen? It's like nobody has any say in the matter. At the last trump, all of a sudden, it says the dead shall rise and those who are alive shall be caught up. Like you don't have a choice in the matter. And that's what's happening here. It's not some kind of a physical event. It's a spiritual happening. There are times in your life where God will just speak words and he will cause you to enter into a kingdom or a throne room experience all by himself. You cannot open your eyes up to the kingdom of heaven. What did Jesus say to Peter? Jesus said to Peter, listen, my Father showed this to you because you do not have the ability to see this. Only God by himself can pull back the veil and show you what he wants to show you. It's the voice of the trumpet. When he speaks and when he wants you somewhere, you're going, man. What's this free will? You find that once in the Bible for me, okay? We'll talk about that later. I don't want to get... But you find free will in the Bible. Ain't no free will in the Bible. There's his will in the Bible. Yeah. When God speaks, it happens. You got free will. You got free will until God says you don't have free will, and you don't have free will. How you like that? It's his will, man. He does what he wants when he wants. You think you're going to say you got free will? Does anyone here think they're going to say no to God? Oh, I say no to God all the time. Okay, sure. Sure. Believe me, God's in charge. Okay, so that's the voice of the trumpet. Very nice. Moving along. Come up hither, right? Mm-hmm. All right. Somebody read for us verse 2 again, please.
Immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne.
Excellent. Is that all of verse 2, by the way? Yes, it is. That's all there is. Let's talk about it. Okay, guys. Immediately, I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven. It's not like, you know, all of a sudden John showed up. It's like, John's here. Let's set up the throne. John's here. It's like you think all of a sudden God set up his throne in your life. Okay, you allowed me to be king today. Okay, bring out the throne. They allowed me to be king today. Bring it out. You think that, because you and I, you know, we don't say words like that, but we live lives like that. You're like, I'll let you be king. Okay, bring the throne out. I'm allowed to be king today. You see, that's not what's going on. It's like all of a sudden John's eyes were opened, and what it says here, a throne was set. Actually, it was not placed, but it was situated, literally lay. It's like John just became aware, like, oh, God's in charge. Oh, his throne is in heaven. I thought so many other things ruled the world. I was battling ISIS and this and that and my mother and my boss. Oh, there's a throne in heaven. Ha! Because I was ready to give it to this guy. But there's a throne and he's in charge of everything. Who are you yelling at all day long? God's in charge. All of a sudden, John had a vision, an epiphany. Oh. Oh. Not only was there a throne in heaven, what else? And somebody actually sat on the throne. That's really what it's saying. I believe that's what it's saying. I believe it's like, epiphany, there's a throne and somebody sitting on the throne. Guess what? It ain't you. John's like, there's somebody on the throne, and it ain't me. It is God the Father. It was there the whole time. Where? Right here. Up in heaven? Yeah, but we already said where's heaven is. It's just that, you know, the veil is rolled back and you're actually able to see something that always was. There is a throne and God is sitting on the throne. There's nothing else ruling this world or this earth or people but God. But God. Yeah. Yeah. It says, I don't know if I want to talk about that yet, but this aspect here, let us be comforted. I think God wants to comfort us and wake us up and everything else. And the fact that, you know, even with, as you go on with the setting, you know, we talked about, it says that there's a rainbow around the throne. Remember reading that just like 5 minutes ago? It says there's a rainbow around the throne. And you know the rainbow that was around the throne? It's not like the rainbows you see on earth. You know the kind of rainbows you see on earth? It's a half a circle. You don't see the full circle. You only see half a circle. But in heaven, you know what you see? A full circle. You see a full circle, a full rainbow around the throne. And that's what it's vertically around the throne. So like when you're on earth and you see the rainbow, you only have a half perspective. You know, if you're in the heavens, you see the full perspective. That rainbow actually covers the whole earth. Like God, every now and again, he lets you see a picture of heaven. Every time you see a rainbow, it's like you're John, and all of a sudden you see the bow in heaven. You see the bow in heaven, and what is a circle? The earth. So where's God's throne? Right here on earth, man. His throne is in the middle of the rainbow, which is here. It's earth, man, not up there. Here, earth, earth. His throne is right here. It's in the middle, in the center of the rainbow. Well, where's the rainbow? Well, you see it all the time. You know where the rainbow is. Where's his throne? In the very middle of it. John finally sees that his throne is right in the very middle of this rainbow. Where is heaven? Where's his throne? Where's all this spiritual activity, these seraphims, these cherubs? Where is everything? It's right here. It says that you and I don't see it until he lets us see it, huh? It's right here. All of this is right here. And he gave you the rainbow as a sign to show you where it all is. His throne is right in the middle of it. Not only is it in the middle of this rainbow, like he's here and you got this rainbow all around him, there's also another circle around him this way. There's a circle around the throne this way, vertically, and there's a circle around him horizontally. You know what the throne around him horizontally is? It's all the thrones and the living creatures and humanity. It's me and you. It's all the people of the world. Where's his throne? Right in the middle of it all. In heaven? Yeah, but where's heaven? It's here. It's here. And you know, you see it sprinkled throughout the literature of the Bible, heaven on earth, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. You see it at the end of the book. You know, heaven came down, the new heaven, the new earth, they're combined, right? So where is this heaven that everybody's going to? Well, it's just it's an understanding. It's a revelation, if you will. It's not a location that we're going to. I don't know if that disappoints you. Some of you might disappoint you. Oh, I was so looking forward to getting out of here. I really was looking forward to getting out of here. And his throne is right in the middle of these two circles. Every time you see a rainbow in the sky, know that his throne's right in the middle of it. And what about the other things all around it? That's me and you. That's the 24 thrones, the living creatures, the seraphims, whatever else is around the throne. People. Wow. I just didn't know it. That's why even coming to church tonight, you know, it's like, you know, oh, it's been a long week, or it's only been half a week, really. But it's like, this is the only thing that matters. This is life. This is life. And when we don't see this, we're like in the church age with a veil in front of us, only seeing through a glass darkly, trying to understand and thanking Jesus for the church because the gates of hell shall not prevail against us. But heaven is available to you all the time. Yeah. This is what John has experienced and what he saw. And this is what you and I are now experiencing and seeing. His throne is right here, and all the people of the world that are around him. Praise the Lord. And you see, let's read. It says, the key word in this chapter is throne. It's used 14 times. Isn't that amazing? In fact, this key word in the entire, this is the, a key word for the entire book. Throne is the key word. It appears 46 times in the book of Revelation. Throne. No matter what may happen on earth, God is on his throne. That's what John saw. God is on his throne, and he is in complete control. Yeah. God, John is emphasizing the glory and sovereignty of God. You know what I believe God wants to continue to show us, and I think he wants to show us in our day and age, in our culture, something extraordinary. I think he wants to open up our eyes and set us free. You know, so many times we live our lives as if we're such failures, as if we're constantly failing God. Like, you could probably start your morning every morning. I don't know, maybe I'm just speaking for myself. But it's like you can start your morning every morning and saying, I'm sorry, Jesus. I'm just so sorry. Does anybody feel like that sometimes? One person, two people, three people, the rest of you are in heaven. I understand. This morning I want to start the day and say, I'm sorry, Lord. I think that's a good way to start the day. But it's like, and if it's not for us, it's for those around us and for the world itself. We think like we and the earth and everybody is constantly failing God. It's trying. I don't think that's reality as far as heaven's perspective. I don't think God thinks that way or sees us that way. I think God is very pleased. I think God is sitting upon a throne. You know, because we're still back and forth between God's anger and God's not happy. And God, I don't think so. I don't think God is so upset and besides himself about what you do all day long, as you are. You're upset by the things you do. He's not so upset by them. And you probably never heard a preacher say that, but I don't think God's so upset by them. I think we are so sin conscious, always measuring good and evil. But God is not sin conscious, and he's not measuring good and evil. I don't think he's upset with you as much as you are upset with you. Because sometimes, you know, and I think that's the answer too, because you say, well, how do you get rid of the evil of the world? Well, you stop believing that you're evil. That's how you get rid of the evil of the world. You got to believe first. And then you see, you got to believe first. You got to believe first. I think God wants to cause us to believe that we're not bad and evil, and it's not a roller coaster life. He's not constantly happy with us, sad with us, happy with us, sad with us. We did good, we did bad. Only in your mind. He's fine with you. Yeah. He's fine with you. Man, that's a life changer. And you know what? Even in your own mind, I don't think your earthly minds will definitely not grab hold of that one. But I think God wants to show us this and give us this understanding. He does not see the world like you see the world. He does not see you like you see you. He does not see your neighbor like you see your neighbor. No, he doesn't. And with this transforming from the church age to the kingdom, remember, you know what happens in the kingdom? You don't see the devil in the kingdom. The devil's not in the kingdom. Evil is not in the kingdom. Whoa, that's kind of, and you can give all your rational answers to that. But the truth of the matter is, you must first believe. It's a walk of faith. You believe and you cause those things that are invisible to become visible. Listen, if you believe you're a rotten egg, you're going to act like a rotten egg. Thanks, brother. If you believe you messed up, you're going to mess up the rest of the day. It's like, who cares? I messed up anyway. I've done that one. Like, it's been a bad Friday? Just make it the whole weekend. Because God don't see us that way. God don't see us that way. And then Monday you get right. Well, Sunday, I'm sorry, no, not Monday, it's too late. Sunday you get right. God. Sometimes you don't make it, and I'm not going, I didn't make it. I'm not feeling too good. But you see, God don't see us as you, because then on Sunday, on Monday, oh, everything's fine? Oh, just poof, everything's fine? Well, you live your life like that, and so do I. The truth of the matter is, if you're okay, everything always was fine. God didn't change, you changed. You thought Friday, Saturday, and Sunday was bad and Monday's good. No. Friday, Saturday, Sunday was good. You just didn't believe it. When you believe you're evil and you're no good, you're going to do more evil. Those who were, it's in the end of the book somewhere, you know, if you're evil, do more evil. If you're righteous, do more righteousness. If you believe you're evil, you're going to do more evil. I've done it myself. If you don't believe it, I believe it. I've done it. When you believe you're good, you're going to do more good. Yeah. Yeah. And God constantly is constantly reaffirming you of his love, of his forgiveness, of his goodness. Thank God. If it were not for the love of God, we would all be consumed. He constantly keeps us from being consumed of ourselves, not of him, of ourselves. I do not believe that God sees us like we see us. I don't believe that this life is such a struggle and we're always failing and trying. Only we see us this way. God does not see us this way. I don't know. I don't have it all figured out, and you don't have it all figured out, but maybe we can start to, or God will start the process of changing our minds where I don't have to think I'm a wreck every morning and just know that I'm okay with God. God loves me, and that will perpetuate the kingdom of heaven in my life. Right, man? Okay. So even with this aspect of the throne and everything, the throne, it's the symbol of victory. The throne. Why do you want the throne, man? Why do you want the throne? There's nothing higher than the throne. You go to England. Is anybody higher than the queen? No, no. No one's ever higher than the queen. Right? No one's ever higher than the queen. There's nothing higher than the throne. You cannot live a better life. You could not have a better life than a life that has access to the throne, and not only has access to it, but actually sits upon the throne. That's why you want the throne, because it's the best life of all. It's to sit upon a throne. You might say, what does that mean to me? Everything. It's what you seek and run after all day long, a good life. That's why it matters to us. All right, so on and on. Let's see. It tells you of his appearance of Jasper and Sardine. Sardine, Jasper and Sardine, easy now. All right, we'll go on. We talked about round about the throne. Can you see it under verse 3 in the commentary, round about the throne?